James was the man when I came to San Antonio. You know, James was the man, and I accepted that. You know, he was our leader.
James Silas was one of the most fundamental guards in that era. And this was before George Gervin was the star. James Silas was the star.
Guts. He had guts. And he held us together as a point guard in the early days. And nobody played harder than James Silas.
I think he was one of the most respected players on the team. He was not talkative. He led by his play.
Silas would go one-on-one with whoever who was trying to guard him, and it was amazing how many times Captain Late hit the last shot.
As great a player as James Silas was, his personality was just so dominant and so overwhelmingly powerful. I mean, this guy was just one of those spiritual forces of nature like few others.
The cool, he was cool, and everything about him, he reeked of coolness.
He is just a man around boys. And he was the captain of our team.
Entering their sixth and ultimately final season in Dallas, the Chaparrals of the ABA were fighting to stay alive and in the news. A trip to the piney woods of East Texas to take on the equally shaky Houston Rockets of the NBA in the preseason, it hardly seemed like a worthwhile solution to either.
And so we're in Stephen F. Austin. We're playing the game. You go in, you come back out. I'm sitting there. And all of a sudden the crowd gets all excited and this kid comes in and just lights our ass up. I literally didn't pay that much attention. Okay, there's somebody here that's, but that was Stephen F. Austin, that was James Silas, trying to make the Rockets team. But back then they had Newland, they had Murphy, there was no way that he was gonna make that team. And within a week, Babe McCarthy said, you're gonna play with us.
The learning curve from NAIA to the ABA proved steep initially.
You know, when you come to the pros, the biggest problem you have is blending in and learning the game. The game's very, very advanced compared to college.
And he struggled. I mean, there were some games, we were in Denver, and Ralph Simpson, who was backing him down and just scoring at will, and James was having a hard time, and we were in the huddle, and I went to Babe, and I said, look, I can come and help, and double Simpson, because he's just punishing him. And Babe says, no, worry, he'll be all right.
And Jimmy picked it up great. He really picked it up well. And throughout the year, he just get better and better and better. And then he came to San Antonio, and the rest is history.
Silas finished second in the league's Rookie of the Year vote. The Spurs overcame a slow start with the mid-season acquisition of the Virginia Squires, George Gervin. But despite the flashy and prolific newcomer's game, there was never a doubt who was getting the ball when it mattered most.
The guys that was on the team with me here in San Antonio allowed me to play to my strength. And I was always told that if I don't do the things I needed to do, we couldn't win. It might have been pressure, but it was a good pressure.
James had an incredible dribble and an outstanding mid-range jump shot that you don't see today, and he was just an incredible tough player to guard.
He knew how to create space. He knew how to use his body. He knew how to create space. Everybody don't know how to do that with his size. He knew how to back you down, and get you up in the air, bump you, and get the shot off or make you foul. And so that there in itself is a talent, that everybody don't have.
Where it's almost like the old North Carolina four corners. There would be four people spread out, one in each corner and one back.
And just give the ball to Silas. And he would back down the defender to about the free throw line and just turn and jump over him. He'd either score or shoot free throws.
He was very explosive. And what made it even more I guess, more effective player. He was a tremendous free throw shooter. And you would either foul him and he'd go to the line and make two, or he would score.
He was the kind of guy, it was 110, 109, and they had the lead. And they fouled him and with no time left. This is how confident I was. I can go in the locker room. Because I know it's over. I know he will not miss a free throw.
But it was easy, because there's something I did. I mean, nobody could stop me one-on-one. I mean, come on.
I don't ever remember him missing a big buzzer beater type shot, and he made so many of them.
And so we started calling him the late Mr. Silas. Well, he didn't like that at all. He didn't want to know part. So then it became Captain Late, because he was captain of the team, and he was a late game guy. And that's how his nickname came about.
You know, I'm not responsible for the Captain Late, but I was responsible for, in the ball games, I started saying, the late Mr. Silas. And I don't know whether it was a reporter or who it was that piggybacked on that and took it and turned it into Captain Late. But he was a clutch player. He had great balance and was such a nice person to go with it.
In his first of two appearances, Silas was on the roster when the ABA All-Star Game came to Hemis Fair Arena in 1975. The now entrenched Spurs fans were looking to the following season as the payoff for everything that had come before. An off-season merger had the Spurs playing in the NBA, and as Silas had been doing since leaving Tallulah, Louisiana, Captain Late was ready to show the world what he and his Little League teammates were all about. Fate had different plans for number 13.
We was in San Marcos, Texas, playing an exhibition game against, at that time, Kansas City, well, now the Sacramento Kings. Kansas City Kings. And there was a guy named Bill Roberzini. I was standing guarding somebody, looking away, and then he fell into my knee. He took a charge and fell into my knee. I had never experienced no injury. So I tried to walk it off, stayed on the floor. So I came back to San Antonio and they told me, hey, got a torn cartilage. I'm like, what do that mean? it was a heck of an experience because I changed my game. I mean, like, I can't jump over everybody now. I got to go to my left more. I had to do things different.
James Silas, one of my favorite players ever. And it's just tragic that he never got to show his skills.
He was a special kind of ball player, man. It's just so unfortunate, man, that the NBA didn't really get a chance to see how effective he really was.
The NBA never really saw James Silas with two legs, two knees.
But when your body doesn't work, there is just no way that you can do what you need to do in the NBA. And few players ever could do it the way that James Silas did.
Limited to just 37 games the following season, Silas eventually found a way to alter his game to offset the limitations. By 78-79, Silas was playing more than 27 minutes a night, averaging 16 points. By playoff time, it wasn't just Silas back. It was Captain Late.
James would have his moments where he would come in and dominate. In that seventh game, he hit the big shot that tied it with very little time left on the clock. It wasn't George taking it, it was Cy. It just, nothing but net.
Silas played two more seasons with the Spurs and one in Cleveland before settling in Austin. San Antonio never forgot about the Almost Rocket who became their original star. In 1984, Silas's number 13 became the first ever jersey retired by the franchise.
You know, everybody called me the original. Jimmy was the first. You know, he was the first. I mean, he first number to be retired.
It never happened before to me or the franchise. So I've never been around and seen it done to no one. But as the years passed, and you look at all the people that played there, out of all the things that was done there, you must have done something special and done it well. We were special to each other. You were special to us, and we're gonna show you how we felt about you too. So it was huge. And as I got older, it just magnified how it really felt and what it meant. And it's something that can never be changed. So it's awesome. It's awesome to even to think about it. How I felt at that time and how I feel now. It's just untouchable, man.